You talking to me?
Himself playing, brash, charismatic young guys, from the streets. It is like how he first made a name for himself. The streetwise, cocky, they're not the upper class, they're the lower class, and they're, and they got the bravado of the lower class, and they've got the charisma. And that's totally how De Niro entered, our consciousness, in the mean streets and everything. What's to me interesting is not so much that De Niro necessarily embodies America, he embodies New York. He embodies that New York style, that New York Italian sense of, coolness that was, in particularly exploded in the 70s. I knew an actor in an acting class that I was in who for 5 years, including the time when I knew him, would walk around, had a picture of Robert De Niro and Harvey Keitel. Not even a picture of them together, just separate pictures. A picture of Robert De Niro and Harvey Keitel in his wallet. And he had it for 5 years in his wallet every day. Reminding him how when he saw Mean Streets, that made him want to be an actor.
Come on, girls, give you coats. Hey, give you coats. If you don't mind, young lady, I would like to check these. I'll keep them with you. Skin pants.
De Niro comes in and stirs up the pot of the movie. He's so out of control. I mean, you don't know what he's going to do next. And you know the minute that De Niro walks into a scene, no matter whatever the course that the scene had take, he's going to up the ante 15 times.
Why don't you lower the jukebox? I can't even look.
Hey, the girls like the music loud.
Girls, you call those skanks girls.
What's the matter with this kid, huh?
Hey, there ain't nothing wrong with me, my friend. I'm feeling fine. Keep your mouth shut. Hey, you tell me that in front of this asshole.
All right. We're not gonna pay. We're not paying.
That's Johnny Boy's character, all right? But that, it can only work. It wouldn't work if Johnny Boy was the lead of the film, all right? It can only work with Charlie's depth and his, his quiet character work. With the two of them bounce off together.
Give yourself a drink. Give Charlie and me a J&B, will you, please?
What's this?
What?
This.
What?
That, what does this look like?
Huh?
What?
Where'd you get this?
What?
Where'd you get this?
What?
This.
What?
And De Niro is ultimately, has become the quintessential New York icon.
I borrow money all over this neighborhood, left and right, from everybody, and I never paid them back. So I can't borrow no money from nobody no more, right? So who does that leave me to borrow money from but you? I borrow money from you because you're the only jerk off around here that I can borrow money from without paying back, right?
I mean, I've always, been a big fan of actor-director teams. Anthony Mann and Jimmy Stewart. Baedeker and Scott. Mastroianni and Fellini, De Niro and Scorsese is right up there in the top, if not for me, the top one, James Monaco, in his book American Film Now, makes the case that De Niro was probably the greatest filmmaker of the 70s, all right, by his association with talents that he worked with through the 70s. Everybody wanted to work with him, and also at the same time, and this holds true to today, at the same time, if, you know, if De Niro is in your movie, you know, you've got major prestige, all right, because he is the best out there. But the thing about it, though, is in the 70s, he didn't work that often, and the people that he worked with are the people who were at the forefront of, you know, the most interesting filmmaking being made at the time. De Niro was it. He was who everybody in my acting classes wanted to be. You know, he was the ideal, you know, to be Robert De Niro. That was the end all. You know, and you had some people want to be this guy, want to be that guy, but I mean, he was the focus, the way Brando was the focus. And his work affected you in very much the same way. People idolized him. And the way young filmmakers now want to be Scorsese, that's the way actors felt about De Niro. And you ran to see his new movie. You know, you ran there to see it. You couldn't wait to see it, all right? You know, to see his new work, and was it as good as the last one, and what did you think about it? And then you'd do his scenes in class, and he was the ideal to everybody. You know, and Godfather 2 kicked it off, you know, giving a performance, some of the entire performances in Italian. He was terrific in the film. He played Vito Corleone. And he never played Brando in the movie. You know, Brando as a young man would have given him far different performance than De Niro gave. What Coppola did, in effect, was truly 110% make De Niro a star. Because he said, this is Marlon Brando as a young man. This whole movie is about the legacy that this man started and his son is continuing. And built this big giant epic and put De Niro in the center of it, trusting that De Niro could pull it together. And he did. But when you have a director of the epic size of Coppola looking at you with those eyes and you rise to the occasion, you're gonna, you know, the effect was he made him a star. When you see Brando in The Godfather, he's like the beginning and the end all of wisdom as far as how to maneuver around his field. I would think the hook that De Niro took was the getting of that wisdom. The experience that formed the old man being able to say, that's Michael. And that comes through.
Gesù uno sei mesi d'anticipo, ma non ci regisce niente a te, è una cristiana orgogliosa. E mi venisse a trovare in dannaggio sei mesi.
Capito, come si
dice? Ma c'è tu cane a prestare, eh?
Eh?
Tu cane a prestare.
Sto cazzo! Sto cazzo! E tu cazzo sì, che stai andando a calma in ordine a mia mano di comando. Oh! Tu stai attenta come parlo con me, capisci? Ma se noi alcune cose non ti vuole usare, non ti manda a sbattere. Andiamo a farci volare, tu mentre la strada, andiamo a baci.
Non fai sto piacere. Mica di chi sono? Io uno scodo. E spiacere l'amici tuoi in questo vicinato che sono io. Io ti sanno dire come io sa ciò fa volere.